Good afternoon. The next item of business this afternoon is a statement by Mark MacDonald on the Child Protection Improvement Programme, and the Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Mark MacDonald.
Ago, the then Cabinet Secretary for Education set out this government's intention to implement a Child Protection Improvement Programme. In doing so, she acknowledged the strengths inherent in the current system, but acknowledged weaknesses that required addressing to ensure we are doing all we can to protect Scotland's children. In the last year, we have been working closely with partners across the children's services sector to honestly scrutinise child protection in Scotland and determine the changes which are required. Today, I am publishing the Child Protection Improvement Programme report and the report of Catherine Dyer's Systems Review, Protecting Scotland's Children and Young People. It is still everyone's job. Presiding Officer, I can advise that I accept in full all of the recommendations and actions in each report. The effective and efficient implementation of this suite of recommendations and actions will strengthen all aspects of the system to better protect our children. Before I outline the key findings and indicate the steps to be taken to ensure implementation, I want to thank everyone who has worked closely with us on the improvement programme. Their time, effort, knowledge and expertise has helped us to develop meaningful and substantial recommendations. I'm very grateful to Catherine Dyer for leading the Independent Systems Review and to the members of this review group and their broader advisory groups for their thoughtful contributions. Every child in Scotland who has been harmed or abused or who is at risk of harm or abuse should receive the best possible support and protection, no matter their circumstances or where they live. The risks children face and our understanding of those risks continue to evolve, and our system needs to continuously adapt to address these. According to the most recent figures, we have 2,751 children on the Child Protection Register. While this represents a 4% decrease on the previous year, the number has increased by 34% since 2000. And while more children left the register due to an improved home situation, more were also on the register for over a year. Generally, the systems review concluded that when children or young people are identified as being at risk of significant harm or have been harmed, then the system works well to protect them. The need for improvement must be set within this context, but, Presiding Officer, we cannot and must not shy away from the challenge before us. One of the most profound impacts on the welfare of our children is neglect. Neglect is the primary maltreatment issue that children in Scotland currently face. 39% of children placed on the Child Protection Register had been emotionally abused, and 37% had suffered from neglect. In addition, lack of parental care is the most common reason for referral to the children's reporter, with 5,606 referrals in 2015-16. Over the last 10 years, we have undertaken significant investment to support parenting, to better prevent neglect and to address the issues which give rise to neglect, such as the Early Years Change Fund, public social partnerships, the Lloyds TSB Partnership Drugs Initiative, the expansion of free childcare and the Family Nurse Partnerships. And we've continued this investment with a programme of action on neglect that is working with local agencies in three local authority areas to look at how practice change can be effected to work with families more effectively based on the best available local, national and international evidence. An evaluation of the early work on this programme will report to me at the end of this month, and I will consider carefully the outcomes of this work. Much has been done over the years to update legislation to strengthen the rights and well-being of our children. One area, however, where the law is out of date is Section 12, Cruelty to Persons Under 16, of the Children and Young Persons Scotland Act 1937. This provision targets physical neglect and harm of children and young people, but does not take account of our modern-day understanding of neglect. We now know that emotional and psychological neglect can be just as devastating for children and young people as physical harm. Yet Section 12 is still the criminal legislation in operation today. The archaic language of Section 12 also means that the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal have difficulty in prosecuting some offences due to its limitations. I can therefore confirm, Presiding Officer, that new legislation will be brought before this session of Parliament, introducing a new definition and criminal offence of abuse and neglect of children. Given that it has taken 80 years as a society to make this change, it is vital that we get it right. We will therefore consult this year to determine the scope and nature of the legislation. Through the Improvement Programme, we have also published an updated action plan to tackle child sexual exploitation, which includes a revised definition and supporting document to guide practitioners, and we've run a national campaign to raise awareness of what constitutes sexual exploitation, particularly among parents. We've consulted on a draft human trafficking strategy that includes a focus specifically on children, and we're working with stakeholders, and particularly children and young people, to develop a revised Child Internet Safety Action Plan, which will be published shortly. We're working with the Children's Hearings Improvement Partnership to help identify action to strengthen consistency and effectiveness across the children's hearing system. Presiding Officer, I'm clear that this improvement programme must not be seen in isolation. The Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry will consider whether further changes in practice, policy or legislation are necessary in order to protect children in care in Scotland from such abuse in future. Should recommendations for change result from the inquiry, it is essential that we honour the integrity and spirit of the inquiry and make changes to do all we can to avoid the abuses of the past. We must also ensure that we allow the independent root and branch review of the care system to shape child protection in the future. This review will look at the underpinning legislation, practices, culture and ethos of the care system in Scotland and provide care experienced young people the opportunity to speak directly to government. The Child Protection Improvement Programme has augmented and reinforced our understanding of the factors which can diminish the capacity of parents to meet their children's needs and keep them safe. Multi-agency planning for and delivery of child protection in local areas is increasingly practised. This should be replicated in national policy, planning and delivery too. A national child protection policy will therefore be published, identifying all the responsibilities and actions across government which are aimed at supporting families and protecting children. As part of this national child protection policy, we will develop a plan to better prevent the emotional, physical and sexual abuse of Scotland's children. This will build on the work I have already outlined and will be designed to respond to emerging threats and challenges, as well as incorporate evidence of practice, activities and interventions which work. The aim is to provide agencies and practitioners with an evolving resource which supports their skills, knowledge and expertise. We all need to feel confident that the processes in place to protect children are working effectively. The system review recommends that we consider how to create a national child protection register. While work with partners will begin to explore how best to establish a national register and how it might work, in the short term we will work with Police Scotland to develop a flagging system on the National Vulnerable Persons Database to identify all children placed on local child protection registers. We must also ensure that the processes for learning in the child protection system are rigorous, timely and effective. Where a child has died or suffered significant harm through abuse or neglect, we must always consider what might have been done differently to have prevented that tragedy, or what could be done differently to minimise the risk of a similar tragedy occurring. That is why we expect child protection committees to undertake significant case reviews and share them with the Care Inspectorate so that it can analyse reviews and report nationally on key areas of learning. The review concluded that we could learn more if the Care Inspectorate also received copies of all initial case reviews, and I agree. The Care Inspectorate will now take on this expanded role and explore how best to share findings to influence practice. I am also writing to all child protection committees to make clear my expectation that they all follow the guidance and will now share all case review findings with the Care Inspectorate. National standards will also be provided for those who carry out reviews to make sure they have the right skills to ensure that reviews are conducted timelessly and consistently. Analysis by the Care Inspectorate of recent significant case reviews found that the time taken varied from 5 months to 37 months, with criminal proceedings often complicating matters. The protocol between the Crown Office, Police Scotland and Child Protection Committees on significant case reviews and criminal proceedings is being reviewed and will be further publicised in order to reduce delays in concluding SCRs. Inspections are also key to the effectiveness of the child protection system. I have asked the Care Inspectorate to host a short-life working group to look at how joint inspections can better focus on the experiences of and outcomes for children at the greatest risk of harm. The group will consider all relevant recommendations emerging from the Child Protection Improvement Programme and draft a new inspection framework ready to replace the current programme of inspections, which end in December 2017. While it is important to have the right processes in place and to effectively evaluate these, it is people which keep children safe. And our frontline practitioners undertaking this most difficult and often harrowing work need to know that they are supported through effective leadership. They need to know that they are supported by effective governance, responsible scrutiny, and appropriate management information. Leadership was identified as a key focus for the improvement programme, not least because too many joint inspections have identified variable and weak leadership. For this reason, in June last year, the Deputy First Minister, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport, and I held a summit for the leaders of services with a role to play in child protection in the public and third sectors, to emphasise the importance of collective responsibility and hear experiences. The systems review also considered the importance of leadership and governance, and as a result of its findings, I can announce today that I will chair a new National Child Protection Leadership Group to support, strengthen and improve activity on child protection. This group will seek to embed consistency and reduce duplication in local areas. It will also support the implementation of the recommendations and actions in both reports, and it will expect agencies to work collaboratively to deliver improvements and achieve sustained, meaningful change. The National Leadership Group will also identify how best to evaluate improvement and measure progress. Catherine Dyer's Systems Review Group was tasked with considering whether a statutory underpinning was required for key aspects of the child protection system. The group concluded that legislation by itself would not deliver improvement. It recommended a range of other actions before moving to legislate. I have carefully considered this conclusion before accepting it. However, I am clear that we must see real progress in implementing the improvements recommended by both reports, particularly to address consistency of approach. If in a year's time there is little evidence of real and substantial progress in delivering improvements, then this government will bring forward legislation to provide an appropriate underpinning for child protection committees, the use of child protection register, and the conduct and application of initial and significant case reviews. In particular, it is vital that I see evidence of consistent good practice within child protection committees, of effective leadership within community planning partnerships and engagement by all relevant agencies, of adherence to child protection guidance, and that initial and significant case reviews are being undertaken when necessary, shared with the care inspectorate, and the agencies can demonstrate practices changing as a result of relevant findings. We now have in place a child protection improvement programme which can and must move rapidly from reflection to implementation. We must move from pockets of good practice to a culture of good practice across the whole child protection system. Presiding Officer, this government is determined to ensure that more of Scotland's children get the best possible start in life. For the most vulnerable in our communities at its most fundamental level, that means protecting them from harm and abuse. We must continue to embed a GIRFEC approach in children's services. We must also continue to invest in activity which supports families and intervenes early to prevent difficulties arising and escalating. But we also need to ensure that we have a system in place which empowers practitioners to intervene to protect children when support is not working. That system must value its workforce, and it should be accountable and committed to a process of continuous improvement to address emerging risks and challenges, and which is focused on adapting and improving practice based on what works. The recommendations and actions contained within the Child Protection Improvement Programme report and that of the Systems Review set out a clear pathway to achieve our vision and ambition for Scotland's most vulnerable children.
Thank you. I would encourage all members who wish to ask a question to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on Liz Smith.
Thank you, and could I thank the Scottish Government for prior sight, but also for their constructive engagement on what is obviously a very serious issue, and one that I'm sure will bring cross-party support. Clearly, we've had some issues in recent weeks about the Protection of Vulnerable Groups scheme, and the Minister's quite right on page 3 to cite the fact that this doesn't happen in isolation. There are other areas, and one of the things about the Protection of Vulnerable Groups that has been a considerable worry is that whilst the legislation is in the right place and while the guidance is in the right place, some of the groups that have been using Protection of Vulnerable Groups haven't managed to have a satisfactory way of documenting that. And particularly when it comes to sports clubs, etc., I think there's been a very worrying gap in some of that. Could I ask the Minister if he would be able this afternoon to tell us about how that aspect of child protection will be pursued?
Minister.
I'm grateful to Liz Smith for her constructive and consensual approach towards the steps that I've outlined. In relation to the PVG scheme, she'll be aware of the evidence that myself and Aileen Campbell gave to the Health and Sport Committee last week. I can announce that I have published the terms of reference for the review of the PVG scheme, and indeed I wrote to the conveners of both the Education and Health and Sport Committee to advise them of those terms of reference. I'm more than happy to write to Liz Smith and to other spokespeople to share those terms of reference with them following the conclusion conclusion of this debate, and that is going to essentially look at the practice and operation of the scheme and some of the issues that Liz Smith has identified. So that review is now underway in relation to the PVG scheme, and some of the questions that she has raised will absolutely form part of the thinking in relation to that, because she's correct to identify that there is no one single aspect of the system that guarantees children are kept safe, but those all form part of a wider jigsaw which ensure the safety of children. So it's important that we get that right, and I will share the information in relation to the PVG scheme review with her.
Ian Gray, to be followed by Fulton MacGregor. Ian Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and my thanks to the Minister for early sight of his statement. We certainly welcome any progress towards protecting our children, and the two reports published today seem on a first glance, for we've not had them for very long, but do seem to be exactly that, and it's good then that the Minister has accepted all of their recommendations. Our remaining concerns are around the speed of what has been quite a lengthy process. It was in 2014 that the Brock report was published, with the author sounding alarm bells after 18 months when, as she put it, little had happened. It was a year ago that the then Cabinet Secretary came to this chamber to respond and launched the two reports that we see today. So, welcome though their recommendations are, many are for further reviews, consultations, evaluations, research or drafting of plans. So what assurances can the Minister give us today with regard to the urgency with which he believes he can see the work elaborated here delivered?
Minister.
Well, I thank Ian Gray for his comments in relation to the government's approach to the recommendations. In terms of the 2014 Brock report and then the subsequent statement, if he looks at page 49 of the Systems Review Group, he will see that Jackie Brock was one of the members of the Systems Review Group whose recommendations I am accepting. So Jackie Brock has been involved in the formulation of those recommendations. He'll also know from the statement I just made that while I am not taking steps to put elements of the child protection system onto a statutory footing based on the recommendations of the review group, I do have expectations around the pace of improvement I expect to see, and if I am not satisfied by that, then I will bring forward legislative measures in relation to that. We're also today committing to develop a national child protection register, a national child protection policy, and also to legislate in relation to neglect. So I would say to Ian Gray that while there are areas of this which, yes, require further review and thinking, there should be no underestimating the fact that there are a number of actions following from this which this government will be taking forward, and which I look forward to Ian Gray and his colleagues playing a constructive part in.
Fulton MacGregor, to be followed by Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a former social worker, I'm glad to see that children and families are at the heart of the Scottish Government's Child Protection Improvement Programme. Could the Minister explain how the Children's Hearing Improvement Partnership will support the Child Protection Improvement Programme?
Minister.
Well, thank Fulton MacGregor for his question. And the Children's Hearings Improvement Partnership was asked to scrutinise the impact of recent legislative and practice changes to the children's hearing system and to identify action to strengthen consistency and effectiveness across the system. CHIP specifically considered the impact of increased legal representation hearings. They're taking forward work to ensure that practice and decision-making within the children's hearing system is consistent, positive and purposeful across Scotland. In addition, the Systems Review Group has made specific recommendation that the Scottish Government should review both the measures available to protect 16 and 17-year-olds and whether the Hearings Act, Children's Hearings Act should be amended to allow any young person aged 16 and 17 years old to be referred to the principal reporter. So we will take that work forward. And I would simply echo the point I made in relation to Liz Smith, that alongside the PVG scheme, the Children's Hearings Partnership forms part of that bigger picture of child protection across Scotland. And we look forward to taking these recommendations forward and working closely with the children's hearing system.
Donald Cameron, to be followed by Runa Mackay.
Thank you. I was interested in the response the Minister gave to Liz Smith about the PVG scheme. And firstly, could I just ask him to clarify the timescale for that review? And secondly, given our exchange at the Health Committee last week, when I asked the Minister if he felt the PVG scheme could be made or should be made compulsory, can I ask him if he has given this any further consideration in the light of his statement today?
Minister.
Thank you. Well, as Duncan will know, I said at the Health and Sport Committee, firstly, that the review we expect, if legislation is required off the back of it, that we would have legislation passed by 2019. So I would anticipate, based on that, that the review will conclude its work within this calendar year. But I will get back to him and give him the firm timescales in relation to that. In terms of his follow-up question, I'm afraid I'm just going to repeat what I said to him at the Health and Sport Committee, that I don't think it would be sensible for me as a minister to stand up in this chamber and preempt the work of the reviewer on whether or not the PVG scheme should be mandatory. That is rightly work that the review should undertake and should consider a body of evidence in relation to that. It is one of the questions which ministers will be giving active consideration to, but I don't think it would be a helpful step for me to say in this chamber either yes or no to it being mandatory before we have actually undertaken the work of the PVG scheme review.
Rona Mackay to be followed by Monica Lennon. Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the setting up of a working group to consider how joint inspections might better focus on outcomes for children. Can the Minister outline his views on how a new approach to inspection could ensure the agencies, especially Education, Health and Children's Services, could work together more effectively to deliver better outcomes for children and young people?
Minister.
Well, I want to ensure that joint inspections of services for children and young people are underpinned by prevention, early intervention, and partnership working, that they recognise that child protection is a collective responsibility, they are transparent in learning, use evidence to effect practice improvement, enable practitioners to make the right decisions at the right time to protect children and support the workforce. And I think Rona Mackay gets to the nub of the issue here when she mentions the various different agencies who need to be working together in order to ensure that children are protected. We have to ensure that it is viewed as everybody's responsibility and that we're not seeing people working with silo mentalities. So that will form very much part of the work around both the joint inspections, but also in terms of the leadership group.
Monica Lennon to be followed by James Dornan. Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In his statement, the Minister said, we must also continue to invest in activity which supports families and intervenes early to prevent difficulties arising and escalating. We can all agree that early intervention to prevent harm from occurring in the first place is absolutely crucial. What assurances can the Minister give today that social workers and all other practitioners involved in the protection of children at that crucial early intervention stage will be able to access the resources they need to do their jobs?
Minister.
I would point to headcount in relation to the Scottish Social Service workforce, particularly in relation to children's services. Data collected for us by the Scottish Social Services Council, which shows that from 2012 to 2015, the number of social workers working in children's services has increased from 5,550 to 5,960. I would also highlight to Monica Lennon, as well as I think I've done in previous debates in this chamber, either to herself or to her colleagues, the work that Audit Scotland did, which showed that there had been real terms increases in terms of spending in relation to social work within Scotland. So I think those pieces of evidence put together would demonstrate that there is a collective focus and a collective will towards ensuring that these services are not just available but are also well resourced. Beyond that, I highlighted a number of other areas where this government is taking forward work in relation to early intervention. And I would also highlight to Monica Lennon the Children and Young People Early Intervention Fund, which this government took forward, and which obviously a large part of that fund I announced in the debate in relation to the care review is being targeted specifically to look at how we work with children either in care or on the edge of care as well. So these are all areas of work the government is taking forward so that we can intervene early to protect children, prevent them from coming to harm, and also prevent them from having to come into contact with the system in the first place.
James Dornan to be followed by John Finney. James Dornan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will of course be aware that the Education and Skills Committee has begun its own exercise to take stock of the reforms to the children's hearing system, and we will of course share our findings and make any recommendations that arise from that to inform this wider Child Protection Improvement Programme. Can the Minister advise how he will reciprocate and involve and include the committee in this vital work, and in particular, when he might be able to advise who will be on the leadership group that he is setting up?
Minister.
Well, I welcome the committee's interest and input into the Child Protection Improvement Programme, and of course I'm more than happy to engage with the committee and provide regular updates in relation to progress in these areas. I'm currently giving careful consideration to membership of the National Leadership Group, but I'm clear that the group must consist of individuals who have demonstrated a track record of strong leadership. So I will provide an update to the committee once the membership of the group has been agreed, which I would expect to be next month.
John Finney to be followed by Liam MacArthur. John Finney.
Thank you, President Officer. I'd like to thank the Minister for early sight of the report and commend the good work that's in it, which will clearly enhance children's rights. The Minister will be aware of a member's bill I'm hoping to progress to remove the defence of justifiable assault, which will similarly enhance children's rights. So I look forward to the review of Section 12 and the subsequent legislation. Minister, Recommendation 11 talks about understanding children's experiences. And the government has a very good track record of engaging with looked-after children and people in formal settings. More challenging would be to understand the experience of children, the vast majority of those involved, who live at home or in domestic settings. Has that been considered, how their views could be taken on board, please?
Minister.
I thank John Finney. I would just correct him. I think he mentioned Section 11. It's Section 12 of the 1937 Act. So I just want to make sure that that's correctly understood. And he also mentioned his member's bill, which, of course, I've committed to discussing further with him. But this government will obviously wait until publication of that member's bill before we take a position in relation to its content. He mentions children who are looked after at home, and he is absolutely right to say that that is a group that we need to ensure that we have consideration towards. Actually, just this morning, I was in Perth meeting with organisations who are going to be delivering mentoring to children who are looked after at home. So the government is giving careful consideration to how best we can capture the views and experiences of children looked after at home, because he's quite right, when we look at the outcomes for those children, they're not what we would want them to be. So I will give careful consideration to how best we can capture their views as part of our wider commitment to listening to the voices of those children and young people who have care experience.
Liam MacArthur to be followed by Christina McKelvey. Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, President Officer. Can I too thank the Minister for early sight of the statement and welcome his willingness to accept the recommendations put on record. My thanks to Catherine Dyer and others involved in this thoroughgoing work. As well as maybe inviting the Minister to clarify some of the funding implications of what he set out, could I focus on the issue of leadership, which I think he rightly highlighted. The predecessor committee to the one James Dornan now chairs looked at the issues that he's very much at the heart of his statement. And one of the, I think, problems we'd identified was that the loss of experience from frontline social work into management roles, or indeed out of the sector at all. And is there anything I think that he can offer the Chamber by way of a reassurance that that expertise in assessing risk can be retained at the front line? And in terms of the leadership group he's establishing, is there a reason why he chose to not accept the recommendation from the group that this reports to the Minister, but actually that he himself is proposing to chair that group?
Minister.
In terms of funding implications, if Liam MacArthur wishes to write to me with any specific questions in relation to funding implications as a result of actions the government is taking forward, I'll be more than happy to respond to him with specifics. In terms of experience around assessing risk, I think it's important that we ensure that this isn't just about, this isn't just the responsibility of those at the front line, although I take on board the point he makes. We have to ensure that there is, I think good leadership is about ensuring that all staff feel both empowered and capable to assess risk and to analyse and to respond to that. In terms of his point around the leadership group, I had a discussion with Catherine Dyer in relation to this, where I indicated my position that I thought it would be better that I chair this. And I think if I'm going to be placing an incumbency upon leadership in other areas, I think it's important that I demonstrate leadership from my angle, and that I think involves me chairing that group and bringing together those individuals with strong track records to ensure we can look carefully at how best to improve the system.
Christina McKelvey, to be followed by Jeremy Balfour. Christina McKelvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Minister, violence against women and girls has significant consequences for the lives of children and young people. And I see from your statement today that the Scottish Government will consult on changes to Section 12 of the Children and Young Persons Scotland Act 1937. Can the Minister offer any further information on this and outline what impact this update will have in terms of protecting children who live in households where domestic abuse is present?
The Cabinet Secretary for Justice and I met with groups representing children and victims of domestic abuse last month to discuss how the law can be reformed to reflect the impact of domestic abuse upon children. At that meeting, we agreed we would continue to work with them on this issue, and as Christina McKelvey will be aware, the Cabinet Secretary for Justice will introduce a bill in this parliamentary year to provide for a specific criminal offence of domestic abuse between partners and ex-partners. Scottish Government has been working with stakeholders to consider what can be done in that bill to reflect the harm done to children through domestic abuse. Separately, the consultation on reform of the offence of child cruelty or neglect at Section 12 of the 1937 Act will enable us to reflect our understanding of the long-term effects of the experience of emotional and non-physical neglect, along with how the damage wrought by this experience can be just as devastating for the victim as other physical forms of neglect and abuse. So it will also provide a clear opportunity to consider what further law reforms are required to recognise children as victims of domestic abuse, whether through a reformed and modernised version of that offence, or by creating a separate provision to deal specifically with domestic abuse of a child. We'll work closely with stakeholders in the children's sector in development of that consultation, and we'll obviously keep Parliament informed as part of that process.
Jeremy Balfour, to be followed by Daniel Johnson. Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And again, can I thank the Minister for his statement? Can I also remind the Chamber that I am a local councillor here at Edinburgh City Council? A lot of the leadership that the Minister has talked about today will come from local authorities, both councillors and council officers. Can I ask the Minister what work and consultation has he had with COSLA, and what role does he see local authorities playing in delivering this, particularly at the strategic level?
Minister.
I think Jeremy Balfour is quite correct that there are elements of the strategic leadership in terms of the officers at a local authority, but there is also the political leadership and the direction that is given to those officers by local authority councillors. So I'll give some careful consideration to how best we can ensure that that leadership mentality is embedded at an elected member level as well. And obviously the upcoming local elections and the potential for there to be changes in terms of administrations across Scotland perhaps provide us with an opportunity to look again at how we address that and perhaps take that forward with some of the new administrations, but also some of those councillors returning to post, some of whom are obviously individuals who have strong interests and track records in relation to this. So I'll give some of that some careful consideration and I'll perhaps reply to Jeremy Balfour later once we've given that some further thought.
Daniel Johnson, to be followed by Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There are a number of recommendations that place additional responsibilities on the Care Inspectorate. Indeed, the Minister speaks of an expanded role for the Care Inspectorate. Liam MacArthur asked about budgetary considerations. So with that in mind, given the recent budget saw a cut in funding to the Care Inspectorate, what resources will be made available to ensure that the Inspectorate has the staff and capacity in order to meet these new challenges?
Yes.
I have had discussions with the Care Inspectorate before bringing forward these recommendations. I'm confident that the Care Inspectorate is in a position to be able to accommodate the role that I'm asking them to take on, and I would not be seeking to ask them to take on that role if I did not feel confident in their ability to manage that function. But I'm happy to reply to Daniel Johnson further with some more detail, but I would say to him that my clear focus on all of this is ensuring that we have a system that is about continuous improvement and learning from experiences, and the Care Inspectorate has a fundamental role to play in that, and I'm confident that they will be able to play that role.
Richard Lyle, to be followed by Miles Briggs.
Presiding Officer, the Minister has explored today the range of areas which the programme focuses on. I have, however, a question on a particular area. Could the Minister outline what action the Government is taking to protect children from being exploited on social media, including by those who are their parents or close relatives of these children?
Minister.
Well, I want all children and young people to be able to benefit from the opportunities the internet has to offer, but also we have to ensure that they are safe and protected from the risks that can be posed in relation to that. Richard Lyle may be aware of Operation Lattice, which Police Scotland ran last year, which identified more than 500 children aged between 3 and 18 years who were either victims or potential victims of online predators, as well as recovering 30 million images of abuse. This operation has highlighted that online abuse is a national threat and it is happening to children of all ages. So as part of our programme for Scotland, we committed to publishing a refreshed action plan on internet safety for children and young people to ensure appropriate training, support and information is in place. We will be publishing that in the very near future. And in developing this plan, we've worked across government and in partnership with Police Scotland, a number of third sector organisations and Education Scotland. We've also consulted with children and young people. As part of this work, we are in conversation with some of the key social media providers, including Facebook and Twitter, and we will continue to engage with them in an effort to ensure that children who use their sites are appropriately protected. We also continue to be represented on the Executive Board of the UK Council for Child Internet Safety, and in addition to this, the Scottish Government continues to engage with the UK Government as it develops the Digital Economy Bill. So I hope that has given Richard Lyle some assurance that there's a range of approaches being taken forward by this government to ensure children are as safe as they possibly can be online, and I'm sure he will want to take an active interest in relation to the Internet Safety Action Plan when it's published.
Miles Briggs, to be followed by Julian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Figures published by the Scottish Guardianship Service highlighted that 40% of the 262 unaccompanied children it has registered since 2011 were brought to Scotland by traffickers. 9 children were trafficked in 2011. This rose to 32 in 2015. There's clearly a worrying trend emerging, and whilst we welcome today's statement, what specific measures will be included in the draft human trafficking strategy regarding children in light of these figures?
Minister.
Well, in terms of the approaches being taken, what we will be doing is to ensure that we both raise awareness amongst public and professionals how services are being are available in relation to children who have been victims of trafficking. They will continue to be supported through standard child protection processes. And of course, we as a government are taking forward a zero tolerance policy in relation to issues around trafficking. In terms of the specific point he raises, I think what it highlights is the importance of ensuring that the appropriate care and support is available for those unaccompanied children. And I'm sure he would share my discomfort at the approach that appears to be being taken by the government down south in relation to those unaccompanied children, which seems to be suggesting that they have pulled back completely from the Dubs Amendment, which is about ensuring that there is appropriate support and protection given to unaccompanied children. And I'm sure he would join with this government in asking the UK government to think again in relation to that.
And a final question from Julian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given that thousands of neglected children in Scotland are not visible, can the Minister expand a bit further on the action the Scottish Government will take specifically to address the issue of neglect?
Minister.
As I highlighted in my statement, there are, I think, some areas of promising practice in dealing with neglect throughout Scotland, but the Care Inspectorate Triennial Review and the Brock Report both highlighted weaknesses in assessing and responding to instances of unmet need and exposure to risk. We've developed a programme of action on neglect that is now working in 3 local authority areas to identify and implement the best approaches to tackling neglect and building practitioner capacity. In addition, as I highlighted in my answer to Monica Lennon, there is £3.3 million being invested this year through the Children, Young People and Families Early Intervention Fund to charities supporting looked after children and working with vulnerable families to help prevent children becoming looked after. And among those is In Tandem, who I was speaking to this morning, who are delivering mentoring for young people looked after at home. So there is a range of work being done to address the impact of neglect, to identify children who are either at risk of neglect or have experienced neglect, and to then support them to ensure that they achieve positive outcomes rather than some of the more negative outcomes that have been experienced in the past.
Thank you, and that concludes our ministerial statement on child improvement. We'll just take a moment for members to change seats before we move on to the next item of business.